Hello again, neighbors. Welcome to the Parsonage. It's Pastor Don from First United Methodist Church of Brazoria with another stay-at-home daily devotional. The scripture reads, from Mount Or, they set out by way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom, but the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke against God and Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness, for there is no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food? I entitled this devotional, The Back to Egypt Committee, and that came from a discussion I once had with some other preachers as we read that passage from Numbers, along with several other passages in Numbers and Exodus at a Bible study, looking at the trouble Moses had leading the Israelites out of captivity in Egypt and into the Promised Land. I joked that at many churches I'd been associated with, they seemed to have a Back to Egypt Committee. This was a collection of folks who failed to see the manifold blessings of God and the freedom and life He offers through the passion, death, and resurrection of His Son. Instead, they preferred to complain about what they saw the congregation lacking. In other words, why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in this wilderness? Well, that's what the Old Testament tells us happened with Moses' followers in the desert. Seems things were so much better as slaves back in Egypt. We had food, we had water, we certainly had steady employment, well, slavery. We knew where we stood. Instead, out here in the Sinai Desert, it's like we have to depend on God. I think we'd rather have Pharaoh. Friends, can you imagine the hubris? Good grief, as Charlie Brown would say. Think about it. They had freedom, but they were willing to exchange it for slavery at the first sign of discomfort or adversity. But then again, I said this happens in a way in present-day churches, and it does. You see, like the Israelites of old, we too have been freed from slavery. Our litany for Holy Communion reiterates that. We've been saved from, quote, slavery to sin and death, unquote, through Christ Jesus. But like the Israelites, when the going gets tough, we fall back on what we know, our slavery to sin and death days too. Arrogantly, we tend to do one of two things. One, we leave the flock altogether, preferring life, slavery, and death on our own to life together in discipleship. Or two, we look up to God and ask arrogantly, what have you done for me, for us, lately? When God gave the Israelites manna and quail to eat because they were complaining about being hungry, they then complained about being thirsty, to wit, God gave them water. They were never satisfied. Their complaints were the same too. We'd be better off back in Egypt than here following our God, Yahweh. There's a word for such disrespect and dismissive disdain for God. It's called sin. See, discipleship is easy when the going is good. I suspect it's a bit like sailing a sailboat. When the water is smooth and the wind is as expected and the boat is working well, virtually anyone can sail the boat. That's why mariners wish one another, quote, fair winds and following seas. Good sailing conditions, in other words. Oh, but let the weather change, the seas get rough, or something break on the boat, and it challenges the best mariner. It's no longer fun, but work. Maybe it's a good time to quit. Unchallenged faith or fair weather discipleship is a piece of cake, but it's when foul winds blow that our faith is put to the test. In the parable of the sower, Jesus talked about this sort of phenomenon. Speaking of the Word of God affecting the human heart, Jesus said, "Other seed fell on rocky ground where it did not have much soil, and it sprang up quickly since it had no depth of soil. And when the sun rose, it was scorched since it had no root, and it withered away." It's when the sun of adversity rises and beats down relentlessly that we tend to fall away from our faith and back into sin. We look back to our old ways with nostalgia, and unless our roots are deep enough, we'll wither too. Jesus wanted his disciples to know that being his disciples required a radical departure from the ways of the world. He admonished them, quote, "No one puts his hand to the plow and looks back as fit for the kingdom of God." Don't look back. Don't turn back. Rather, stay the course. To be his disciple, friends, you need to be looking out the windshield and not over the tailgate. I mean, it's good technique for driving, well, at least forward, maybe not backing out of the driveway. It's also good farming technique if you look backwards while plowing your furrows will not be straight. You'll go off course. You remember St. Peter walking on the water? While he looked at Jesus, while he was focused on the Son of God, he walked upon the water. But when he got frightened, he looked away and he began to sink. Friends, the church is like that too. When we focus on Jesus and his call to ministry, we'll become part of the miracles and we'll overcome all adversity as Jesus overcame death with the empty tomb. However, if we start to look back to what used to be, we'll fail. And that's never been more important than today in the midst of this ongoing pandemic. Churches can't congregate perhaps for months. Giving, which too often is tied to attendance, goes down. Ministries suffer. Leadership worries. Pastors are worried and nervous. Somebody will say, we had it so much better in the 1950s or 60s or 70s, whatever. But my friends, in truth, discipleship is one step forward. Behind Jesus, one step forward after another. Well, it's a bit like recovering from addiction. We are addicted to sin, after all. And as I understand it, an addict never is really cured, but rather in recovery. And for the rest of their life, it's a battle to say no to their addiction and yes to life. Each new day must be faced step by step, day after day. When life is going good, likely this is easier than when adversity strikes. Then when you have a really bad day, it could be terribly difficult not to look back to the liquor cabinet or one's stash for help. I mean, it's a known quantity. It's poison, but it's a known quantity, and it can temporarily make you feel better. But then sadly, you're again a slave to that addiction. As the church, we need to realize that when adversity, such as the COVID-19, strikes, we mustn't fall back in our worry to sin and ease, but stay the course of discipleship in Christ. Remember, quote, "Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever," unquote. And please accept that there will be adversity, there will be pain and loss, there will be seemingly insurmountable obstacles placed in our way, like the Sea of Galilee before Peter or the Red Sea before Moses. But Jesus made this plain, quote, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me," unquote. Those inevitable adversities and pains are the cross we are to bear, or else we choose not to follow Jesus. Friends, we are sinners in recovery. a recovery powered by faith given to us by God. It's a recovery in community too. We need each other for prayer and support. We also need to immerse ourselves in God's Word, read our Bibles, feast at His table, and touch the water of our baptisms to remind us. Perhaps you recall the immortal words of Charles Wesley's great hymn, "Forth in Thy name, O Lord, I go. My daily labor to pursue Thee, only Thee, resolved to know in all I think or speak or do." As the body of Christ, we must continually commit to go forth in His name, continue to walk on the water, to part the seas together, and not commit ourselves back to Egypt. Grace, peace, and good health always, and have a blessed day.